However, I wish to give special greetings to the members of the East Central Indiana Association of Phi Beta Kappa who are holding their annual meeting on campus today. The group's officers are Jim Pyle, President, Harry Pickle, Vice President for Membership, Ron Rarick, Secretary Treasurer, and Wayne Shirey, ex officio. In addition, Ron Rarick is the President and Lynn Sousa, past President of the Phi Society, the campus organization of faculty and staff who are members of Phi Beta Kappa. Would the members of these two organizations please stand to be recognized? And now for just a little history of the Burkhardt Lecture Series. In 1990, the Burkhardt children donated a substantial gift to the university to begin these lectures. As a result, we have been able to bring to the campus 12 notable scholars, beginning with Amy Gutman, Mellon Professor of Politics and now Provost at Princeton University. Although the lectures have been primarily about European history, often French history, there has also been some flexibility in topic as we sought out scholars of stature, both in the United States and abroad. The intent of the Burkhardt's adult children who provided this remarkable series was to honor their parents' many contributions to Ball State University. Many of us recall Dorothy's outstanding service as a French instructor in the Department of Modern Languages and Classics, and we know of Rich's long and distinguished career as acting president, provost, and vice president of academic affairs, and professor of history. At this time, I ask that Rich and Dorothy stand so that we may thank them and recognize them. Pleasure to welcome back Rich and Dorothy's son Chip and his wife Jane, who have traveled from Champaign, Illinois to be with us on this special occasion. It's probably not at all surprising that Dr. Richard Burkhardt Jr. is a member of the history faculty at the University of Illinois. Please join me in recognizing them as well. Finally, I want to thank former Provost Warren Vanderhill for initiating Dr. McPherson's appearance on our campus and Dr. Dan Goffman and other Department of History faculty for their assistance in hosting this event. And now I take great pleasure in introducing the 13th lecturer of the Burkhardt series, Professor James McPherson, the George Henry Davis 86th Professor of American History at Princeton University. Born in North Dakota, Professor McPherson grew up in Minnesota, graduated from Gustavus Adolphus College, and in 1963 received his PhD in history from Johns Hopkins University. He has taught at Princeton since 1962. Author of more than a dozen books and editor of another dozen, Dr. McPherson is considered to be an authority on the American Civil War and Reconstruction. He has won several book prizes, most notably, of course, the Pulitzer Prize in History in 1989 for Battle Cry of Freedom, the Civil War Era, and the Lincoln Prize in 1998 for Cause and Comrades, Why Men Fought in the Civil War. His most recent book is Crossroads of Freedom, Antietam. Highly respected in his profession, Dr. McPherson has served a term as president of the Society of American Historians and is currently president of the American Historical Association. I'm delighted that Professor McPherson was able to accept our invitation to present the Burkhardt Lecture, where he certainly stands out among the top-ranked scholars in the world. His topic today is the global significance of the American Civil War. Please join me in welcoming Dr. James McPherson.
Thank you, Ms. Pitts. And in recognition of the Burkhardts, this was not intentional, but part of my lecture will have something to say about French history, and so you won't feel completely left out of the subject of the lecture today. The preeminence of the American Civil War in our historical consciousness is, of course, no secret, and I think the fascination with the Civil War is one of the reasons why a good many of you are here today. Dozens of national and state Civil War battlefield parks attract millions of visitors every year. Four popular Civil War magazines publish monthly issues with a combined circulation of about 300,000. Nearly 400 Civil War roundtables flourish around the country, most of them holding monthly meetings, several of them publishing fairly elaborate newsletters. There are estimated to be at least 40,000 reenactors who don their replica uniforms and take up their replica weapons to stage scores of mock battles every year. Some 40 million or more viewers, probably more since it was rebroadcast last fall, have watched the 11-hour television miniseries on the Civil War produced by the documentary filmmaker Ken Burns. Some of you, I know, have seen the movie Gods and Generals that was just released last weekend, another sign of the interest in the Civil War. Good many Civil War museums and museum exhibits have opened in recent years. More are in the planning stages. Elaborate preparations are already underway for the bicentennial commemoration of Abraham Lincoln's birth in 2009, and the sesquicentennial observation of the Civil War years from 2011 to 2015. And above all, books about the Civil War continue to roll off the presses. And the discussion that I was having with some of the Phi Beta Kappa people before the lecture, one of them observed that it's been estimated that a book a day over the last 140 years has been published about the American Civil War, and I think that's probably about right. Well, what explains this fascination with a war that almost tore the country apart? Asking the question that way provides part of the answer. The war almost did destroy the United States as one nation. A division into two countries might have created a precedent for the balkanization of North America into several nations. Union victory prevented this outcome and preserved the United States as one nation, indivisible. Of equal importance, the war also liberated 4 million slaves and abolished the institution of bondage that had made a mockery of America's self-proclaimed renowned as a land of liberty, a beacon light of freedom for the oppressed peoples of the old world. As Mark Twain expressed it a few years after the Civil War, that great conflict, now Twain's words, uprooted institutions that were centuries old, changed the politics of a people, transformed the social life of half the country, and wrought so profoundly upon the entire national character that the influence cannot be measured short of two or three generations. And Twain's estimate of two or three generations was actually conservative. Here we are, five generations later, now in a new millennium, and we're still trying to measure the consequences of a conflict that laid the foundation for the emergence of the United States as a world power, and in fact as the greatest world power in the second half of the 20th century. But that war's cost in lives and resources was extraordinarily high. The 620,000 or more soldiers who lost their lives in the American Civil War constituted 2% of the whole American population at the time. If the United States were to lose 2% of its population in a war fought today, the number of American war dead would be 5.5 million. And of course, the impact on the South was far greater in terms of lives lost. The Southern white population lost 4% of its population, and that would translate today proportionately into an American death toll of 11 million in a war. And that fact suggests one reason why awareness of the Civil War remains much more intense in the South today among Southern whites than among any other groups in American society. As William Faulkner once said of his native section, "The past is not dead, it is not even past." And as any reader of Faulkner's novels knows, the Civil War is the central event in that past that is still present. In his novel, Intruder in the Dust, Faulkner wrote, and this is one of my favorite passages to explain the kind of consciousness of the war, continuing consciousness of the war in the South. This was a novel written back in 1947, but it would apply just as much today. "For every Southern boy 14 years old, not once but whenever he wants it, there is an instant when it's still not yet 2 o'clock on that July afternoon in 1863. The brigades are in position behind the rail fence, the guns are laid and ready in the woods, and the furled flags are already loosened to break out. And Pickett himself, with his long oiled ringlets and his hat in one hand probably and his sword in the other, looking up at the hill at Longstreet to give the word. And it's all in the balance. It hasn't happened yet. And that moment doesn't need even a 14-year-old boy to think, this time. Maybe this time we'll break that Yankee line and win the war. The romanticization of courage and honor in a lost but noble cause does remain alive and well in the South. The lost cause mentality is encouraged by Southern heritage organizations like the United Daughters of the Confederacy, the Sons of Confederate Veterans. Many of these groups feel victimized by what they believe are unjust war guilt accusations against their ancestors for having seceded to preserve slavery and started the war by firing on Fort Sumter. Their impassioned defense of the Confederate flag as a symbol of courage and honor, not a symbol of slavery and racism, is part of the defensive siege mentality, which explains, I think, the emotional attachment of many Southern whites to their Civil War heritage. And of course, those institutions that were uprooted and the half of the country whose social life was transformed, as Mark Twain noted, were in the South. But awareness of the meaning and consequence of the American Civil War were not confined to the South or even to the United States alone. As the largest war in the Western world between 1815 and 1914, it attracted a great deal of attention from Europeans while it was going on and ever since. It's become a cliche to say that we live today in an era of globalization. The Civil War also had a global dimension in its significance, both in its own time and right on down to today. There are several of those Civil War roundtables outside the United States. There are also hundreds of reenactors from European countries, as well as Canada and Australia, who traveled to the United States to participate in these battle reenactments, including the largest such one so far, at Gettysburg back in 1998, at the 135th anniversary of that battle, when a French reenactor portraying a Union cavalryman had accidentally had a live round in his revolver and wounded a Virginian. If the French come back this time, it may be more intentional, I'm not sure. There's going to be another big reenactment on the 140th anniversary in this July. Ken Burns' television documentary attracted many millions of viewers outside the United States, and my own book, Battle Cry of Freedom, was published in a separate British edition and has been translated into French and German. Another personal experience some 15 or more years ago brought home to me the extent of interest abroad in the American Civil War. Back in the mid or late 1980s, I can't remember the exact year, Princeton University hosted an international college debate tournament. And one of the teams was from Krakow University in Poland. A member of that team was fascinated with the American Civil War and had read everything he could get his hands on about it in Poland. He made an appointment with me and we talked for an hour or more in my office about the Civil War. His English was very good. It quickly became clear to me that he identified with the Confederacy, and especially with Jeb Stuart and his devil-may-care cavalry. Part of that interest was a sort of romantic infatuation with Stuart that has seduced many Americans, I think, as well. But a significant part of it stemmed from his empathy with another people struggling for an independent nationality, just as Poland had done over the centuries and was doing even then, in that time in the late 1980s of the Solidarity Movement in Poland, when that country was the most restive member of the soon-to-crumble Soviet bloc. An affinity between Poland and the Confederacy had a long history going back to the Civil War itself. When Polish nationalists rose in rebellion against Russian rule in 1863, right in the middle of the American Civil War, the Richmond Inquirer, a leading Confederate newspaper, drew this parallel. At bottom, the cause of Poland is the same cause for which the Confederates are now fighting against that crushing killing union with another nationality. And that sentiment resonated with the Polish student in my office a century and a quarter later. But what about slavery? I asked him. He didn't want to talk about slavery, except perhaps the slavery of Poland to the Soviet Union. And trying to be a good host, I didn't press him on the matter. Like many Confederates in their time and Southern heritage groups today, he saw the Confederacy as fighting for liberty, not slavery, for self-determination, not domination. In the 19th century, when many European romantics sympathized with small nationalities fighting for independence from big empires, Greece against Turkey, Poland against Russia, Hungary against the Habsburgs, and so on, sympathy with the Confederacy seemed natural, if one ignored slavery. But my Polish friend's empathy with Jeb Stuart was probably the exception rather than the norm among foreigners interested in American history, especially Civil War history. Far and away the most prominent individual whom Americans and non-Americans alike identify with the Civil War is, of course, Abraham Lincoln. Now, this was not necessarily true during the war itself, when Lincoln was more often ridiculed than admired abroad. But his martyrdom by assassination at the moment of victory elevated him quickly to a sort of secular sainthood. And in fact, that's exactly what Leo Tolstoy called Lincoln on the centenary of Lincoln's birth in 1909. Tolstoy called him a Christ in miniature, a saint of humanity. Tolstoy also recounted a story that illustrated the reach of Lincoln's fame in the early 20th century. When Tolstoy was traveling in the Caucasus on one occasion, he met with a Muslim chief who described Lincoln as, and I'm quoting now, a hero. He spoke with the voice of thunder. He laughed like the sunrise, and his deeds were as strong as the rock. These Christian and Islamic images of Lincoln as Christ and Lincoln as a rock were combined in an interesting fashion a half century later by the Hindu Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru, who kept on his desk a bronze of Lincoln's hand and a gold statuette of Mahatma Gandhi. Lincoln's hand, said Nehru, symbolized strength and unity. Gandhi symbolized compassion. Perhaps the outstanding example of Lincoln's international stature occurred in 1959, on the sesquicentennial of his birth, when some kind of commemoration of that event took place in 90 countries around the world. 7 million people in Britain watched a BBC special on Lincoln. 45,000 people in Berlin, including some from East Berlin, came to see a replica of a log cabin where Lincoln was born that was put up in West Berlin. 5,000 West German high school students participated in an essay contest about Lincoln. The Federation of the West Indies also held a Lincoln essay contest, which was won by a young man from St. Kitts, whose essay was actually read into the congressional record, including this sentence. Lincoln is loved and respected by people who have never seen America, people who will never see America, and people who do not wish to see America. The author didn't say which category he belonged to. In any event, for someone who never set foot outside the United States, Lincoln's international fame was and is extraordinary. But in a way, that's appropriate, because Lincoln expressed better than anyone else the international significance of what he described in the Gettysburg Address as a test whether a nation conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal, a government of, by, and for the people, would long endure, or perish from the earth. On his way to Washington in February 1861 to take up the burdens of the presidency of a nation that seemed to be falling apart, Lincoln spoke to the legislature of New Jersey in Trenton, near the spot where George Washington's ragged troops had won a victory the day after Christmas 1776 that saved the American Revolution from collapse. On that occasion, Lincoln said, "There must have been something more than common that those men struggled for, something even more than national independence, something that held out a great promise for the people of the world for all time to come." That something was the affirmation of the Declaration of Independence that all men had an equal right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Lincoln was, as he put it, exceedingly anxious that this Union, the Constitution, and the liberties of the people should be perpetuated in accordance with the original idea for which that struggle was made. The next day, February 22nd, Washington's birthday, Lincoln spoke at Independence Hall in Philadelphia, where the Declaration had been adopted. "I have often inquired of myself," Lincoln said on that occasion, "what great principle or idea it was that kept this Union so long together. It was not the mere separation of the colonies from the motherland, but that sentiment in the Declaration which gave liberty not alone to the people of this country, but hope to the world for all future time, that in due time the weight should be lifted from the shoulders of all men, and that all should have an equal chance." That was the idea that Lincoln thought was threatened by the breakup of the United States into the disunited states in 1861. After the war began, following the attack on Fort Sumter, Lincoln declared, "The central idea pervading this struggle is the necessity of proving that popular government is not an absurdity. We must settle this question now whether in a free government the minority have the right to break up the government whenever they choose. If we fail, it will go far to prove the incapability of the people to govern themselves." And in that same year, 1861, Lincoln told the Congress that this struggle was not merely altogether for today, it is for a vast future also. It embraces more than the fate of these United States. It presents to the whole family of man the question whether a constitutional republic or a democracy can or cannot maintain its territorial integrity. Now, this sense of mission, this idea that the United States is an exemplar of democracy for the oppressed of all peoples around the world, is deeply rooted in American culture. From the beginning, settlers in the New World felt they had a mission to show people in the Old World the path to greater liberty, democracy, prosperity. As John Winthrop told his fellow Puritans as their ship approached Massachusetts Bay in 1630, "We shall be as a city upon a hill. The eyes of all people are upon us." Thomas Jefferson addressed the Declaration of Independence to the opinions of mankind. In 1783, George Washington congratulated his compatriots on the achievement of independence, but warned them, as he put it, that the eyes of the whole world are turned upon you. As Lincoln did 40 years later, Washington declared that the impact of the American Revolution would not be confined, in Washington's words, to the present age alone, for with our fate will the destiny of unborn millions be involved. And on the 85th anniversary of American independence, on July 4th, 1861, when the Civil War was 3 months old, Lincoln acknowledged that our popular government has often been called an experiment. 2 points in it our people have already settled, the successful establishing and the successful administering of it. One still remains, its successful maintenance against a formidable internal attempt to overthrow it. If that attempt succeeded, Lincoln believed, if the Confederacy broke the country in two, the forces of reaction in Europe would smile in smug satisfaction at this proof of their contention that the upstart republic launched in 1776 could never survive, that it would be swept into the dustbin of history, the unhappy fate of most republics through the past. And indeed, in the mid-19th century, the United States stood almost alone as a democratic republic in a world bestrode by kings, queens, princes, emperors, czars, petty dictators, theories of aristocracy. Some Americans still alive in 1860 had seen two French republics rise and fall. The hopes of 1848 for the triumph of popular government in Europe had been shattered by the counter-revolutions that brought a conservative reaction in the Old World. Perhaps the United States was indeed, as Lincoln said, the last best hope of earth for the success of government of, by, and for the people. Many in the North shared Lincoln's conviction that democracy was on trial in the Civil War. As an Indianapolis newspaper put it 2 weeks after the firing on Fort Sumter, "War is self-preservation if our form of government is worth preserving. If monarchy would be better, it might be wise to quit fighting, admit that a republic is too weak to take care of itself, and invite some deposed duke or prince of Europe to come over here and rule us. But otherwise, we must fight." And the outbreak of the war in the spring and summer of 1861 brought hundreds of thousands of Northern volunteers to recruiting offices. Some of them expressed a similar sense of mission, democratic mission, as a motive for signing up. In 1863, on the second anniversary of his enlistment, an Ohio private wrote in his diary that he hadn't expected the war to last this long. But no matter how much longer it took, it must be carried on, now his words, for the great principles of liberty and self-government at stake. For should we fail, the onward march of liberty in the old world will be retarded at least a century, and monarchs, kings, and aristocrats will be more powerful against their subjects than ever. Several foreign-born soldiers, and indeed the Union Army, about 25% of the soldiers in the Union Army were foreign-born. Several foreign-born soldiers appreciated the international impact of the war perhaps even more than native-born men who took their political rights for granted. In 1864, an English-born soldier, a 40-year-old corporal in an Ohio regiment, wrote to his wife explaining why he had decided to reenlist for another three-year hitch. "If I do get hurt, I want you to remember that it will be not only for my country and my children, but for liberty all over the world that I risk my life. For if liberty should be crushed here, what hope would there be for the cause of human progress anywhere else?" And an Irish-born carpenter, a private in the 28th Massachusetts Infantry of the famous Irish Brigade, rebuked both his wife in Boston and his father-in-law back in Ireland for questioning his judgment in risking his life for the Lincoln administration and for the Union. And with some asperity, he wrote back to them, "This is the first test of a modern free government in the act of sustaining itself against internal enemies," almost an echo of Lincoln. "If it fail, then the hopes of millions fall, and the designs and wishes of all tyrants will succeed. The old cry will be sent forth from the aristocrats of Europe that such is the common lot of all republics." It's worth noting, by the way, that both this Irish-born carpenter and that English-born corporal I quoted were killed in action in 1864. Now, as I think most of you are well aware, many people outside the United States today find this continuing American sense of mission, that belief that we have a mission to lead others from darkness to light, to be irritating at best, infuriating at worst. Such self-righteous posturing is often likely to inspire resentment rather than admiration abroad, especially when preached by a superpower whose own house is sometimes none too clean. And in the 19th century also, these manifestations of a sense of mission did provoke resentment or ridicule abroad. But such attitudes in the 19th century were expressed mainly by upper-class conservatives and aristocrats, mainly in Britain, particularly in Britain, rather than by the liberal or radical left, as they so often are in our time. Many British spokesmen for the middle and working classes in the 19th century actually echoed the most chauvinistic Yankees in pointing to the United States as a model, as a beacon of freedom. During the debate that produced the British Reform Act of 1832, the London Working Men's Association pronounced what it called the Republic of America as a beacon of freedom for all mankind, while a British newspaper named The Poor Man's Guardian cited American institutions as, in its words, the best precedent and guide to the oppressed and enslaved people of England in their struggle for the right of representation for every man. In the preface to the 12th edition of his Democracy in America, written during the heady days of the 1848 democratic uprisings in Europe, Alexis de Tocqueville urged the leaders of France's newly created Second Republic to study American institutions as a guide, in Tocqueville's words, to the approaching irresistible and universal spread of democracy throughout the world. When, instead of democracy, France got the Second Empire under Napoleon III, the Republican opposition to Napoleon's regime looked to the United States for inspiration. Many of the suggested reforms, wrote the historian of the French opposition, would have remained utopic had it not been for the demonstrable existence of the United States and its Republican institutions. When the South seceded and war broke out in 1861, a good many European aristocrats and monarchists made no secret of their hope that the United States would indeed fall into the dustbin of history. The most recent historian of British attitudes toward the American Civil War maintains that Britons looking across the Atlantic saw in the American conflict a mirror that reflected the tensions between aristocracy and democracy in their own society. What this historian calls the Americanizers in Britain, who wanted to broaden working class rights and voting rights, favored the North. What he calls the anti-Americanizers, who dominated the press and parliament, tended to sympathize with the Confederacy. Some anti-Americanizers expressed delight, at least in private, at what one of them called the immortal smash of the dis-United States in 1861, which demonstrated, as he put it, the failure of Republican institutions in time of pressure. The Earl of Shrewsbury looked upon what he called the trial of democracy and its failure with pleasure. "I believe that the dissolution of the Union is inevitable," he said, "and that men before me will live to see an aristocracy established in America." The voice of the British establishment, with a capital E, the Times of London, considered the downfall of what it called the American Colossus to be good riddance of a nightmare. "Excepting a few gentlemen of Republican tendencies, we nearly all wish success to the Confederate cause." As these words suggest, British sentiments toward the American war tended to divide along class lines, with the upper classes and the gentry, the aristocracy, favoring the Confederacy, middle and lower classes favoring the Union. There were many exceptions to that, of course, and so the generalization is subject to qualification. But I think, nevertheless, it's true that most members of that minority of Britons who owned enough property to vote in 1861 and who were therefore represented in Parliament probably would have welcomed Confederate success. The foremost British champion of the Union cause and of expansion of democracy in Britain, an MP named John Bright, explained to an American friend, "Our government is made up of men drawn from the aristocratic families, and from a natural instinct it must be hostile to your greatness and to the permanence of your institutions." When Sir John Ramsden, a Tory member of the House of Commons, voiced satisfaction that the great Republican bubble has burst, loud cheers from the backbenches greeted those words. The American minister to the Court of St. James, Charles Francis Adams, was not too far off the mark when he wrote in December 1862, "The great body of the aristocracy and the commercial classes are anxious to see the United States go to pieces." The British people paid a lot more attention to this war across the Atlantic among their American cousins than did people in other nations. Nevertheless, monarchists and conservatives elsewhere in Europe tended to share the opinion that the war demonstrated the failure of democracy. In Spain, for example, the royalist journal Pensamiento Español found it scarcely surprising that Americans were butchering each other. "After all," this newspaper declared, "the United States was populated by the dregs of all the nations of the world. Such is the real history of the one and only state in the world which has succeeded in constituting itself according to the flaming theories of democracy. The example is too horrible to stir any desire for emulation." And the minister to the United States from Russia echoed this opinion in 1863. The Republican form of government, so much talked about by the Europeans and so much praised by the Americans, is breaking down, he wrote. What can be expected from a country where men of humble origin are elevated to the highest positions? And of course, he meant Lincoln, whose reputation in Russia in 1863 evidently was poles apart from Leo Tolstoy's opinion, a half century later. This is democracy in America, the minister continued. The democracy that European theorists rave about. If they could only see it at work, they would cease their agitation and thank God for the government which they are enjoying. And Louis Napoleon, Napoleon III of France, certainly agreed. He was the European ruler most inclined to recognize the Confederacy, although he never did because he wanted British support to do it, and the British eventually backed off. A French Republican exiled in Switzerland exaggerated only slightly when he wrote in 1862 that the purpose of Napoleon's desire to recognize the Confederacy as an independent nation was, as this Republican exile put it, to weaken or destroy democracy in the United States, because in order for Napoleonic ideas to succeed, it is absolutely indispensable that this vast republic disappear from the face of the earth. Well, now, whether or not Napoleon thought that he could destroy republicanism in the United States, he did try to do so in Mexico. That country experienced its own civil war in the 1860s between a reactionary alliance of the church and large landowners on one side against the followers of the Republican liberal Benito Juarez on the other. Napoleon was also willing to go along with his fellow emperor, Franz Joseph of Austria, whose younger brother, Ferdinand Maximilian, was at loose ends with little to do. So why not set him up as Emperor of Mexico, thereby reclaiming at least part of the vast Spanish dominion once ruled by the Habsburgs? King Leopold of Belgium, Maximilian's father-in-law, all these European royalty were related to each other, had an additional purpose in mind. Leopold described the Lincoln administration as characterized by what he called the most rank radicalism. And he feared that if the North won the war, America, in collaboration with Europe's revolutionaries, might undermine the very basis of the traditional social order of Europe. So he favored the installation of his son-in-law, Maximilian, as Emperor of Mexico in 1864, as he put it, Leopold put it, to raise a barrier against the United States and provide a support for the monarchical aristocratic principle in the southern states. I'm not sure that Jefferson Davis would appreciate it being called an exponent of the monarchical principle, but that's how Leopold saw it. What this demonstrates, I think, is that opinion in Europe certainly seemed to support Lincoln's conviction that the very survival of democracy was at stake in the Civil War. But in the first year and a half of the war, the problem of slavery muddied the clarity of this issue as it had for many years. One of those European revolutionaries of 1848 who was forced to escape and come to the United States, Karl Heinzen, part of the German 48ers, as they were called, who came to the United States, became an abolitionist in the 1850s and emphasized the impact of slavery and the slavery controversy on America's image abroad. As Heinz had put it, slavery was a moral and political cancer that will by and by undermine all republicanism. And the anti-slavery movement is a battle against reaction in Europe. This republic, the United States, cannot and will not be able to do anything for European freedom until it has shaken the yoke of slavery from its neck. Having abolished slavery in their own colonies, European nations professed distaste for the survival of the institution in this boasted land of liberty. Even autocratic Russia had ended serfdom in 1861. In January 1862, Abraham Lincoln told Carl Schurz, the most famous of those German 48ers who had come to the United States, Lincoln told Schurz, "I cannot imagine that any European power would dare to recognize and aid the Southern Confederacy if it became clear that the Confederacy stands for slavery and the Union for freedom." But when Lincoln said this, the Union did not stand for freedom. constitutional constraints plus Lincoln's need to keep border slave states and northern Democrats in his war coalition had so far prevented efforts to make it a war against slavery. This restraint perplexed and alienated many potential European friends of the Union cause. As one perturbed Englishman put it in 1861, "Since the North does not proclaim abolition and never pretended to fight for anti-slavery, how can we be fairly called upon to sympathize warmly with the federal cause?" And spokesmen for British workers, who were torn between their sympathy for the Union as the representative of free labor democracy on one hand, and the suffering of the textile workers in the textile industry because of the cutoff of cotton from the South on the other, the spokesman for British workers also expressed puzzled anger. "Now that it is clear that Northerners in America are not fighting for the emancipation of slaves," declared an editorial in the British Labor newspaper in October 1861, "we are relieved from any moral consideration in their favor, and as the Southerners are not worse than they are, why should we not get cotton? If the North, in blockading the Southern ports, had had emancipation in view, we might have seen the sacred cause of free labor was on their side. But since that was not the case," he said, "why should we starve any longer?" Lincoln recognized the force of that question. In September 1862, he agreed with the delegation of anti-slavery clergymen that emancipation would help us in Europe and convince them that we are incited by something more than ambition. When he said that, Lincoln had made up his mind to issue an Emancipation Proclamation. The balance of political forces in the North and of military forces on the battlefield had changed just enough to give this decision the impulse of public support, although it did remain very divisive for a while. And Lincoln was waiting for a Union military victory to give the Emancipation Proclamation legitimacy and impetus. That victory finally came at Antietam on September 17, 1862. 5 days later, Lincoln issued a preliminary proclamation warning that in all states still in rebellion on January 1, 1863, he would use his war powers to confiscate enemy property by proclaiming slaves in those states forever free. January 1 came, the war still raged, and Lincoln signed the final proclamation. He told colleagues who had gathered in his office to witness this act, "I never in my life felt more certain that I was doing right than I do in signing this paper. If my name ever goes into history, it will be for this act, and my whole soul is in it." Lincoln's name, of course, did go into history for that act as much as for anything else that he did. The proclamation prompted the beginnings of an historic swing of opinion in Europe. In England, huge mass meetings passed resolutions in favor of emancipation in the North. Young Henry Adams, secretary to his father at the American legation in London, reported, "The Emancipation Proclamation has done more for us here than all our former victories and all our diplomacy. It has created an almost convulsive reaction in our favor." A pro-Union member of Parliament, Richard Cobden, told an American friend in February 1863 that the outpouring of support for the Union among the middle and working classes in Britain has shut the mouths of those who have been advocating the side of the South. Recognition of the South by England whilst it bases itself on Negro slavery is an impossibility. The impact abroad of Union victory in 1865 settled a good many questions that had remained in dispute throughout the Civil War and the period before it. The Italian patriot and revolutionary Giuseppe Mazzini told the northern people in 1865, "You have done more for us in 4 years than 50 years of teaching, preaching, and writing from all your European brothers has been able to do." And none other than Karl Marx declared in 1865, "As in the 18th century, the American War of Independence sounded the tocsin for the European middle class, so in the 19th century, the American Civil War sounded it for the working class." European conservatives looked at the other side of this coin. Back in 1862, when prospects had appeared dark for the Union, the British Tory leader, Benjamin Disraeli, stated his belief that the United States could never be cobbled together again, and that the America of the future, as Disraeli put it, will be an America of rival states and maneuvering cabinets, of frequent turbulence and of frequent war. The failure of that prediction disappointed more than one of Disraeli's conservative colleagues. Another Tory MP, a critic of American culture and democracy, remarked sourly to an American acquaintance in 1865 that he considered Union success a misfortune. "I had indulged the hope that your country might break up into two or perhaps more fragments. I regard the United States as a menace to the whole civilized world." And one of his associates spelled out that menace, which he called the beginning of an Americanizing process in England. The new democratic ideas are gradually to find embodiment. And in a way, that prediction proved true. Union victory encouraged liberals in Britain who wanted to expand voting rights there. For almost 4 years, they had endured the taunts of the establishment who pointed to that immortal smash in the United States as evidence of democracy's failure. Our opponents told us that republicanism was on trial, recalled Edward Beasley, a liberal political economist at the University College London in 1865. They insisted on our watching what they called its breakdown. They told us that it was forever discredited in England. Well, we accepted the challenge. We staked our hopes boldly on the result. Under a strain such as no aristocracy, no monarchy, no empire could have supported, republican institutions have stood firm. It is we now who call upon the privileged classes to mark the result. A vast impetus has been given to republican sentiments in England. Well, it wasn't entirely true. Queen Victoria's throne was safe. England did not become a republic, but a two-year debate in Parliament, in which the American example figured prominently, led to enactment of the Reform Bill of 1867, which nearly doubled the eligible electorate and enfranchised a large part of the British working class for the first time. With that act, the world's most powerful nation took a long step toward democracy. What might have happened to the Reform Bill if the North had lost the Civil War, thereby confounding liberals and confirming Tory opinions of democracy, is impossible to say. If progress toward democracy in Britain was at most an indirect consequence of the American Civil War, the triumph of Benito Juarez and republicanism in Mexico was, in part, a direct result. The United States sent 50,000 veteran troops to Texas after Appomattox, while Secretary of State William H. Seward pressed the French to withdraw their troops from Mexico. Napoleon finally did so in 1866, whereupon the Republican forces regained control of the country, captured Maximilian, executed him in 1867. 3 years after the fall of Maximilian, Napoleon himself lost his throne, an event attributed by the historian of his liberal opposition in part to the example of triumphant republicanism in the United States 5 years earlier. Well, I think that's probably pushing things too far. The birth of France's Third Republic was a consequence of French defeat in the Franco-Prussian War, not of Union victory in the American Civil War. Nevertheless, it may have been more than coincidence that within 5 years of Union victory, the forces of reform had expanded the suffrage in Britain and had toppled emperors in Mexico and France. Back in 1861, as I quoted earlier, Lincoln had said that the struggle for the Union involved not just the fate of these United States, but of the whole family of man. It was a struggle not altogether for today, he said, but for a vast future also. We are living in that vast future. Lincoln's words resonate in the 21st century with as much relevance as they did 70 years ago. I'm sure Lincoln would have applauded the sentiments of a 17-year-old girl from Texas who was a finalist in an essay contest on Lincoln's legacy a few years ago, yet another one of these Lincoln essay contest. This girl, whose forebears had immigrated to the United States from India, wrote, If the United States was not in existence today, I would not have the opportunity to excel in life and education. The Union was preserved not only for the people yesterday, but also for the lives of today. Well, we can only speculate about the possible fate of this young woman if the United States were not in existence today. Even more speculative, perhaps, is the possible fate of Britain and other countries in the 20th century if that Tory MP had gotten his wish and the United States had broken into two or perhaps more fragments in the 1860s. Perhaps we would all be speaking German today or Russian. And as we go forward into the new millennium, such speculation is limited only by the horizons of our imagination. Thank you. I'll be glad to try to answer your questions. I'll recognize you and then repeat the question so that I make that we make sure everybody's heard it. Yeah.
What kind of weight do you think the United States, or what was left of it, could have given to the world in the Cold War if it had been divided in half or even?
The question is, what kind of weight could the United States have given and what kind of role could it have played in the world during the Cold War if we had remained divided into two or more countries? Well, I think it would have made a vast difference well before the Cold War. The absence of a powerful United States in both of the two world wars might have made a great difference in the outcome of those wars. There might never have been a Cold War. There might never have been any number of other events that happened in the 20th century if North America were divided in the same way that South America was divided, which was a distinct possibility. If one secession is legitimized, then there are likely to be more. That was certainly the principal, one of the principal fears of Northerners in 1861, that if the South could get away with secession, then in a future time with a disaffected regional minority, it would secede as well. We take for granted the existence of the United States as one united nation today, but the Americans before 1861 couldn't, or 1865, could not take that for granted. And without the existence of a powerful united country occupying most of North America, it's hard to say what the history of the world in the 20th century would have been, but I'm confident that it might have been quite different. Maybe for the worse and maybe for the better. No one can know. Yes, way back there.
In the reserve powers clause of the Constitution, which indicated that escaping that certainly came up with power, it was understood to contain that. The Constitution was silent on the issue of how one could withdraw from the federal union. Lincoln put his stamp on it to say that, you know, when he joined the Union of Perpetuity, what was the other side of this argument?
Did you, everybody hear that question? Do I need to? The question is first pointed to the 10th Amendment to the Constitution that reserves to the rights to the states any powers and rights that were not granted, specifically granted. Lincoln's justification for not accepting the legitimacy of secession was that the implicit rule of all government is perpetuity. And indeed, the Articles of Confederation, which were superseded by the Constitution, said that these United States shall exist in perpetuity, and the preamble to the Constitution says that its purpose is to create a more perfect union. So Lincoln pointed to these as authorization, as justification for insisting on the illegitimacy of secession. What was the Southern argument in response to that is the question. The South, or the secessionists in the South, developed what they called the compact theory of the Constitution, that it was a compact among states that had ratified it in 1788 or 1789. And in the process of ratifying it, had yielded part of their sovereignty to the United States government. But having ratified that constitution by the convention of a state, they could withdraw that ratification by another convention, and that's how southern states, except Tennessee, all the other southern states, seceded by means of a state convention, which in effect withdrew its ratification from what they called a compact. Because in yielding some attributes of sovereignty to the United States in 1789, southern states maintained, they did not yield the fundamental properties of sovereignty itself. That still resided with the states, and they sometimes pointed to the 10th Amendment to justify that. So there was this kind of irreconcilable argument over the meaning of the Constitution and whether the Constitution permitted or did not permit anybody to withdraw from it at will, because the Constitution says nothing explicitly about that. Yes? Question is, how would this have been adjudicated by the Supreme Court of 1861 if it had gone there? Well, as you know, or at least as you imply, five of the justices on that court were Southerners, and six of them had, in effect, one way or another, ratified the Dred Scott decision. So there was a strong bias on the Supreme Court of 1861, which I don't know how they would have decided. Just because they were pro-slavery doesn't necessarily mean they would have been pro-secession. The issue of secession did come before the court 7 years later, in 1868, or perhaps it was 1869, in a case called Texas versus White, which had to do with the legitimacy of bonds issued by the state of Texas when it was a Confederate state. And the Supreme Court of that time, 1868, ruled that those bonds were invalid because secession was invalid, and therefore there was no obligation to redeem those bonds. Well, of course, that was a Supreme Court, most of whose members had now been appointed by Lincoln. And so what else could they say? I think that the question of the legitimacy of secession was not really decided by the court or by the political process. It was decided by war. And no state since 1865 has tried it again. That question was settled. Yes.
You show, I think, totally convincingly that the Europeans in 1861 are looking at the United States and say, they're saying, what this is about democracy. And certainly we know today that France is looking at the United States and saying, this is not about democracy. At what point do the Europeans seem to switch that kind of position today?
The question is, clearly the Europeans in the 1860s were looking at the American Civil War as being about democracy. Today that doesn't seem to be the case in the controversy about Iraq. So when did it change? I think it changed very recently. I think that, and it hasn't changed for every European by any means, but I think in World War I when Wilson called this a war to end wars and a war for self-determination and democracy. In World War II, when Roosevelt and Churchill proclaimed the Four Freedoms, and even through much of the Cold War, at least as far as Western Europe is concerned, the United States in world affairs stood for a symbol or a concept of democracy and freedom. And I think probably for many in Europe that's still the case, but in the current controversy about Iraq, that issue has been much muddied by many ancillary issues and by what looks like a unilateralist and almost anti-democratic position by the Bush administration to defy popular opinion in his foreign policy. And so, and this is certainly the perception of the French and the Germans and others. I think that's a very recent change. and not yet even a total change, because as I understand it at any rate, not all Europeans necessarily agree with that perception of the United States in this. But I think we're in, it's hard to say whether we're in the middle of some kind of historic shift in other countries' perceptions of the United States. It may be true, but it's too soon to tell.
Please join me again.